Hello again, Yuri, and welcome to the Carton Academy's lesson about World War One weapons. Now, you should have already completed a starter activity as part of a Teams live introduction with your teacher, so let's make a start on the lesson. Now, remember to pause the video when I ask you to in order to complete the tasks, and don't forget your teacher will be on Teams for the whole lesson if you have any questions. First of all, could you write down today's title, which is What was the most effective weapon in World War One? We're going to be looking at a range of different World War One weapons today, thinking about what they do and describing them, and then we're going to basically explain how effective they were based on their reliability. And at the end of the lesson, you will be able to come to a conclusion about which of the weapons you thought was the most effective weapon in World War One. So today, as I've mentioned, we're going to be looking at a range of different weapons from the First World War. Now, the weapons that we're going to be specifically focusing on are machine guns, gas, tanks, and flamethrowers. Over the next few slides, as we have done in some previous lessons, I'm going to be going through some information about each of these different weapons. What you've got to do is make sure that you're using subheadings to make sure that you've got your notes very clearly labelled, and then you need to make bullet-pointed notes about each of the weapons. Once you've done that, I will then ask you how effective or reliable that weapon was for use in the First World War. You will then have to make that decision on your own before moving on to the next weapon. Let's get started. So the first subheading that you need to make is machine guns. That's going to be our first weapon that we'll be looking at today. Now you can see a picture of a World War I machine gun just here. They're much larger than any modern day machine guns you may have seen in films or games and things like that. It's much larger. So let's have a look at what the machine guns were like in the First World War. Now first of all, machine guns were actually invented in 1862, but they hadn't been tested in a war before the First World War, so they were a brand new weapon being used in the war. People didn't have much experience of how they would be used in battle. Now they soon became recognised as one of the war's deadliest weapons. And basically, we'll look at this in a bit more detail when we do get on to look at the Battle of Somme, in which so many men were killed, largely at the result of these machine guns. Now machine guns, as you can see, were quite large, and they actually needed about 4 to 6 men to operate them. And they also had to be on a flat surface, as you can see that they had a stand, you couldn't carry them and run around. They also had the firepower of 100 guns, so they were extremely powerful and deadly. These weapons could also become easily jammed. So basically, in the battle, sometimes you could find that the bullets would get jammed and actually it would take a long time to clear that out. Imagine how difficult that would be, obviously, in the battle scenario, as these machine guns were often used to defend trenches. If they became jammed, then basically the military using those machine guns would basically be quite vulnerable. Also, they could fire up to 10 bullets per second. Again, that kind of gives you a bit of a picture of how powerful they were. In the first 12 days of fighting, the French reported losses of over 200,000 men, and this was mostly through machine gun fire. So what that tells us is that in terms of the machine guns, they were extremely deadly weapons for war, and they did actually cause about 40% of all wounds inflicted on British troops during the First World War. The machine guns were used both by the Allies and the German forces. On the next slide, there's going to be a video that I'd like to watch, which tells you a bit more about machine guns, and you can see them in action. It's the historian Dan Snow talking through how these weapons worked. Pay close attention to this video and think about why this weapon had its pros and its cons for war.
This is a very unusual day. I've come to a secret location in the east of England. It's one of the few places in the country that you're allowed to fire heavy weaponry. And I've come here because we're looking at one of the most revolutionary and important weapons of World War I, the machine gun. Machine guns have been tested at this weapons facility for generations, and it bears the scars. Machine guns rose to a position of such prominence in World War I that they came to symbolise the entire conflict. This was a futuristic weapon, unimaginable just a couple of generations before.
Release my Close the top cover. Sight's already up. Pull that one through.
How many crew would these have had?
Anything between 4 and 8.
So it could have had an 8-man crew. There's people loading these belts, there's people carrying the equipment.
You had a guy that pulled the sled on harnesses attached to his webbing. You had the guy that carried the gun. You had the guy that brought all the ammunition up. So we have here the trigger, then we just depress the triggers and away it should go. Okay, done. And now just depress this over to one side and you're now basically ready to fire.
That is a feeling of extraordinary power, given it's the same as rifle ammunition, but it feels like it's a piece of artillery. Amazing. Really amazing. You certainly get the feeling of being on the end of an extraordinary explosive power here. You feel like you're projecting these bullets down the range, unlike anything I've ever experienced before. One of the ways to really get an appreciation for just how many bullets a machine gun is capable of firing is to load it, and that means putting all these individual bullets into an ammunition belt like this. Right, let's fire the Vickers, the British version. I mean, was this a? Do you think it's better than the German version, or what's your opinion on this?
Yes, it was. It was better. It was a lighter gun. It was a very reliable gun.
Because there's that story about the 10 Vickers machine guns, wasn't it? The summer of 1960 at the Battle of Somme, and they all fired continuously for 12 hours.
Yep.
And in that case, they managed to fire 1 million rounds in 12 hours, didn't they?
Yeah. And without any reported failures, which is even more phenomenal. Our safety catches these paddles, which we pull towards us, and this is now our trigger.
All right. Safety?
Safety. Thumbs over the top, that's it.
Firing. You can really feel the shockwaves coming off that one, can't you?
You can. Basically, this is virtually identical to the German, but being much lightweighter, you feel you're more exposed to it. German one was much heavier, much larger.
This one feels more like a sort of wild horse that's a bit skittish. It's a strange thing to come here today and fire these machine guns because you're actually replicating some of the actions that caused the deaths of hundreds of thousands of people during World War I. But unless you come here and understand these and work out what they can do, it's really impossible to understand that slaughter in its entirety. Right, next, I suppose, in a way, it's the odd one out, the Lewis gun.
It is the odd one out, but it actually outnumbered the Vickers 3-1 by the end of the war.
And this was brought into service during the war. This is state of the art in World War I.
It was, and it was the most mobile machine gun of World War I.
Because obviously these ones are quite immobile, aren't they? You know, you think about these ones being used in the classic defensive battles and mowing down the oncoming infantry. This is actually designed to be taken forward. It's an offensive weapon.
It's an assault weapon. Yeah, it certainly is. It is the very first machine gun that was designed really to be lightweight, carry it, and take the fight to the enemy across no man's land. And the Germans hated it. They despised it, but they also admired it when they captured it and they used them in great numbers.
Yeah, they used a lot of them, didn't they?
Yeah.
Right, let's give it a go. Thank you. guys are just de-rigging the guns now, and it's been a shocking but fascinating demonstration of the sheer power of these machine guns. It's probably as close as I'm ever going to get to the sounds and some of the smells of a First World War battlefield, thank goodness. And just looking at these weapons, experiencing the kick and seeing the power that they throw out, it really is a scary thing to think about just how many deaths these guns have been responsible for.
Now that you've made some notes about the machine gun and you've watched the Dan Snow video about machine guns too, I'd like you now to decide how effective and reliable you think the machine guns were in trench warfare. Write a short explanation in your book or on your piece of paper, just saying whether you think it was or was not effective and reliable, and a reason why. Okay guys, the next weapon we're going to be looking at is gas. So basically, as I'm reading through the notes, you need to be making some points about what gas was like and how it was used in the First World War. Now, the first ever gas attack happened in April 1915. The German army basically released gas from cylinders and they allowed the wind to carry the gas over to enemy soldiers. So basically, the wind would carry the gas into the Allied trenches. Now, even though the Germans started off using it, particularly from 1915, they were using chlorine gas, actually the Allies were the ones that went on to use more gas attacks than the Germans in 1917 and 1918. And this was largely because there was an increase in the production of gas from the Allied nations. Germany was actually unable to keep up with this pace, despite having created various new gases for use in battle. Now, in terms of obviously the Allies using more gas, I suppose that's also partly down to the entry of the United States into the war from 1917. And this allowed the Allies to increase the mustard gas production far more than Germany. So that's one of the reasons as to why the Allies were actually using more gas than the Germans in the later part of the war. Now, in terms of the two different types of gas that could be used, chlorine gas and mustard gas had different effects. So first of all, let's talk about chlorine gas. Now that basically was used to suffocate the lungs of those that inhaled it, and it left the victims gasping for air. So it was a really brutal, quite awful death if people suffered from a gas attack. And the other problem with chlorine gas is that obviously it was carried with the weather. Now, of course, the problem with that meant that, of course, the weather had to be right. If you wanted wind to carry the gas into the opposite trenches, you needed to be sure that the wind was going to be travelling in the right direction. If the wind was travelling in the wrong direction, it could actually send gas back to your own troops, causing more damage to your own army. Now, this is quite important as well, because actually the wind on the Western Front was actually often blowing from west to east, which actually meant that the British more frequently had favourable conditions for a gas release than the Germans did, because the Germans, of course, were based more on the eastern side, and therefore the wind wasn't often favourable for them to use gas in that way. Now, the other type of gas was mustard gas. This was dreadful. It could actually sometimes take 5 weeks for somebody to die from the attacks from the mustard gas in World War One. And this was largely because it basically rotted to the body from the inside. Victims would actually cough up the linings of their lungs in clots, which is absolutely awful. And basically the pain was in some cases so intense that victims had to be tied down. Now, mustard gas was actually fired into the trenches in shells instead. Mustard gas is also colourless and it takes 12 hours to take effect. Now, what I'd like you guys to do is think about the notes that you've written down for gas. And I want you to think about how effective, how reliable was this weapon which was being used in trench warfare in the First World War. On the next slide, I'm going to ask you to really think about this and write a paragraph. So now that you've made some notes about how gas was used in trench warfare, I'd like you to decide how effective and reliable this weapon was. Think about whether you think it was or was not reliable for use in the trench warfare in the First World War. And could you also make sure that you write a short explanation as to why you feel that way? Use your notes to help you with that explanation. Please do this in your book or on paper. So our third weapon we're going to be looking at, guys, is tanks. So can you write that down as your next subheading, please? Now, first of all, tanks were a British invention. They were first used in battle in 1916. The But one of the bad things about tanks is they weren't particularly fast. They could only really travel at about 4 miles per hour. The fastest tank around was called the Whippet, and that could only travel at 8 miles per hour, so still really, really slow. One of the other downsides of the tanks was that they broke down quite easily. Now, of course, if you're in the middle of a battle and you're perhaps implementing an offensive strategy, your tank breaks down, it's going to be quite difficult to obviously think about how your plans might work after that. It could definitely affect the process at that point. Now, in terms of how many tanks were made during the First World War, the British and French made 5,000 tanks in comparison with the Germans, who made 20 tanks. They're a little bit behind the Allies in that. Now, in the Battle of Cambrai in 1917, over 400 British tanks actually crossed no man's land. So that's a key point to get down as one example of where tanks were used in a battle. Now, it's important we know that tanks were used essentially to break down barbed wire, they crushed machine gun nets, and essentially they would help to clear the way for foot soldiers behind them. Now, remember that in previous lessons when we've talked about trench warfare, we've mentioned that it was really, really difficult to attack. Trenches were all about defence, and it was really difficult to get out of the top of the trench without being shot down. Tanks being introduced in 1916 was a huge step forward because it meant that tanks could be used to cross no man's land, break down the things that were preventing soldiers from easily crossing no man's land, and allow soldiers to hide behind them and eventually, of course, attack the enemy trenches. So tanks made a huge difference, I would say, in the strategies used in the First World War. Now, it's important we know that in the Battle of Cambrai, 476 tanks were actually used in total by the Allies, and 378 of these were combat tanks as well. Now, in terms of obviously some of the other statistics from this battle, out of these tanks that were being used, 179 tanks were lost in this battle, alongside 44,000 British soldiers. So, of course, even though the tanks made it slightly easier to get across no man's land, it did not mean less losses. There were still huge numbers of deaths, even after the use of tanks in warfare. And also, the Germans lost 45,000 men in this battle as well. So the losses were on both sides. So I just wanted to make that clear that although tanks, of course, could change the offensive strategies, there were some downsides to them, such as the speed, they broke down easily, but also there were still huge losses of life in these battles in which tanks were used. So what I'd like you to do, guys, is make sure you've got some notes down in your books about tanks, how they were used, and what their faults were as well. Okay, so just like we have done with the other weapons, I'd now like you to stop and make a short explanation in your book or on your paper about how effective or reliable you think tanks were in trench warfare. So think about what we looked at in the last slide, where we talked about some of the faults of the tanks, but also one of the things that they could be quite useful for is, of course, trying to get foot soldiers to cross no man's land, which is something that had been incredibly difficult in the early years of the war. So make your decision, guys. Do you think this was quite a reliable weapon to be used in trench warfare, or do you think it was not? Can you make sure you do include an explanation as part of your answer, please? Okay, guys, now our fourth and final weapon is going to be called the flamethrower. And basically you can see a picture of a flamethrower being used by a soldier in this picture here. Now, flamethrowers were first used in February 1915. It was actually briefly used against the French outside Verdun. Now, the way that flamethrowers actually work, as you can see in the picture, a canister of oil is basically strapped to the soldier's back. And then the oil is forced through a nozzle to fire at enemy soldiers. Now, the way that it works is that the oil kind of ignites a spark that creates a sheet of flame that could travel up to 15 metres. Now, that sounds like quite a distance, but you've got to remember that some trenches were much, much further away than that, and therefore they couldn't be used really on a daily basis or in every battle. But the flamethrowers were deadly in small spaces, and that's really important to recognise. So, for example, if a soldier was able to get into the opposite trench, then these flamethrowers could quite often be used. Now, of course, they could be used themselves to be deadly because, of course, they were spraying fire. But ultimately, one of the other ways that they kind of caused harm to soldiers is they caused panic amongst the troop in the trenches. So, for example, if a soldier got into the opposite trench, was spraying essentially the fire around, what that's going to do is cause the troops to panic to try and get away from the fire, and they're going to potentially leave the trenches. Now, if they leave the trenches, of course, machine gun fire will be waiting for them. And actually, the casualties were then mainly caused by soldiers being flushed into the open and ultimately being shot by more conventional means, such as machine gun fire. And that was actually opposed to dying from the fire itself. So flamethrowers were used in World War One, but they were often used in more small spaces, particularly once soldiers were able to carry out offensive strategy and get into the opposite trench. And now, obviously, some soldiers did die as a result of the flamethrowers themselves, but some soldiers actually were shot because of the panic that was caused amongst the troops when the flamethrowers were being used. So it is important, guys, that we mention how flamethrowers were used, but also talk about like the kind of ways that it actually was used at small spaces, as opposed to used from trench to trench. They actually couldn't be used in normal trench warfare, really. It was only once they were able to, I suppose, get into small spaces with the opposition army. That's really important. So what I'd like to do, guys, is just pause this for a second and make sure that you're making notes about the flamethrowers and how they were used. And then, of course, we're going to go in and discuss how effective and reliable these weapons were. Okay, guys, this is the final weapon that you need to write a short explanation for in your book or on your paper. So remember, our question is, how effective or reliable do you think flamethrowers were in trench warfare? Using the information on the previous slide, can you just make sure that you do write a short explanation about whether you think they were or were not effective and reliable to be used in the First World War, particularly using trench warfare? So pause this video again, just to make your paragraph quickly. Well done for making it to this part of the lesson. You've made lots of good notes today, and I hope you found the information about World War I weapons interesting. We've got two final questions that I'd like you to do as today's plenary. I'd like you to have a go at them on your own in your books or on your paper first, and then I would like it if you could share your answers with your teachers on Teams in the last 5 minutes of the lesson using the question and answer box. Now, before you do answer these questions, I would like to just quickly talk to you about what you've looked at today. Now, we've talked about four weapons used in World War I. We've talked about how effective or reliable these weapons were. But I also want to finish the lesson by talking about the fact that these weapons, of course, caused mass destruction in the First World War, and they are responsible for killing hundreds of thousands of men. I also want to talk about the fact that those men that did not die from their injuries were left with lifelong conditions, some mental and some physical. Many men who survived machine gun fire, for example, were left without parts of their face and would have to have plastic surgery to reconstruct their faces. Many men were left without limbs and would have to learn to live with that forever too. It's really important we understand that although we're talking about these weapons, we also have to understand the impact they had on soldiers in the First World War, and of course for many years afterwards as well. I just want you to bear that in mind, of course, as you leave today's lesson. But I have got these two plenary questions for you, and I want you to think about these based on the learning and the information you've looked at today. So question one, did the weapons used in World War I make it easier for an army to attack or defend, would you say, overall? I know that some weapons made it easier to attack and some made it easier to defend, but what do you think overall? Do you think generally weapons in World War I made it easier to attack or defend? Can you make sure you explain why and give some examples? Question two, if you were an army leader at this time, which weapon would you have said was the most reliable and most effective to be used in trench warfare? Again, once you've made your decision, please make sure you explain why using some information from today's lesson. Now that concludes my part of the lesson, guys, so make sure that you do share your answers with your teachers on Teams at the end of the lesson. It's really important so we can find out how well you're understanding the learning that you've been doing today. Thank you very much for listening, Year 8, and take care.